Good morning. I'm not sure I have sound up here, but I'll talk loudly. I do have sound. Good, good. It's great to see you. We always had a tradition in pre-pandemic days when I would say good morning and everybody would say good morning back, and we're getting back into our groove, but it's so good to see you here. It's really different today, isn't it? It's so cool. We're going to have some dancing later on in the service, so we've kind of pushed ourselves over here into the corner, and it's kind of cozy. I kind of like it, and if things get ugly, there's a window where I can escape, so I don't think I'm going to need that, because I'm sure. First of all, I just wanted to, often you'll hear me say thank you for the gift of your presence, and I hope that doesn't just sound like a trite phrase, because it's really something I mean. Your presence here is a gift. If you weren't here, I'd be looking at an empty chair, and not just that, you wouldn't be here in all your wonderful uniqueness. So when I say thank you for the gift of your presence on Sunday mornings, I really mean it. Your presence, you are a gift to this community. And I would love it if you realized and thought about people in your own life who might be feeling disconnected or lonely and would benefit from a community like ours. So when we do our welcome, let's always remember to be thinking of other people that we can welcome into this wonderful community, because it's a beautiful place to be. So I have a riddle for you guys this morning. Are you ready for a riddle? All right, we'll see. So I don't think you're going to get it, but it's okay. I'll bail you out. There are two types of people in this room. The larger portion of you are not aware that the smaller group exists, but those of us in the smaller group are aware that we exist. Those of us in the smaller group are somewhere between 10 and 30% of the population, but those who are not of that in that percentage, those who, the rest of you, lacking our special sensitivity, you don't realize we exist. What the heck am I talking about? So anyway, let me ask a question here. How many of you find it helpful when you sneeze to look into the light or the sun? Not too many. A few of us here, between 10 and 30% of us in the world, have something called something called photic sneeze reflex. Did you know that? You can look it up. Between 10 and 30% of us in the human race, it helps us sneeze to look into the sun. It's something about the way our brain is wired. And so during the fellowship hour, find out who has photic sneeze reflex and who doesn't. Just another way to break the ice with each other. But here's an interesting point. During ancient times, during the solstice, the people with the photic sneeze reflex were the ones who were sent into the hills because they were most sensitive to the light. And when people would hear the sneezing, they knew that the light was coming again. And I'm pulling your leg about that. But I just thought that was interesting about the photic sneeze reflex, that we discover things about one another. And those of us who have it are quite aware that the sun affects us when we sneeze. And those of you who don't have it think we're crazy. But I'm here to tell you, we're not. Anyway, that's enough for our welcome this morning. I think I've said enough. We're going to move on. Photic Sneeze Sunday.
Let love continue long. Please keep your masks on. Let love continue long and show to us the way. And if that love be strong, no hurt can have a say. And if that love remain but strong, no hurt can ever have a say. If love cannot be found, things. When love does not abound, a common faith will fail. When human love does not abound, a common faith will always fail. If we in love unite, debate can cause no strife. For will this love incite disputes enrich our life? For will this bond of human love disputes can mean a richer life? Lead us on our way, for if that love be strong, no hurt can have a say. For if that love remain but strong, no hurt can ever have a say.
Each week, we join our voices to say our affirmation, proclaiming our dedication to love, compassion, service, and community. In order to fulfill this commitment, we must put aside our pride, our privilege, our sense of righteousness, and humble ourselves. We must be mindful of the needs of our brothers and sisters, remembering that we are all human, all fellow passengers on this small blue planet we call Earth. Would you please join me in speaking our affirmation? Love is our doctrine. Compassion is our way. Here we seek to create a joyful hall for free religious exploration, build a community of caring fellowship, nurture the hopes, and serve the needs of our world. Midwinter is upon us. Here on the 45th parallel, halfway between the equator and the North Pole, we're granted barely 8 hours of sunlight each day this time of year, with clouds often obscuring the sun. Here in this sanctuary, this community, we can share love and kindness that warms our hearts and feeds our souls. We can spark a flame, kindle a fire, which will drive away the cold and light the darkness. Here at UUCS, it is our tradition to light 3 chalices each week. The first we light is for our congregation, all of you here, all of those watching us online, and all of those that we have in our hearts. The second is for our partner church in Shimonfalva, Transylvania, Romania. And our third is for the children and youth, whom we task with carrying this light into the future.
Good morning. Every Sunday morning this month, we've woven Advent into our worship life at UUCS. Advent comes from the Latin verb advenire, which means to draw near. By lighting one more candle on our Advent wreath each week, we make visible our spirit of waiting, of expectation. The first candle we lit was in the name of hope, not just what we long for, but our trust for the best within us to rise and to grace the many endings and beginnings in our lives. We lit the second candle in the name of peace, the courage to soften and to cultivate our ability to stay present in difficult moments. We lit the third candle in the name of joy, the abiding faith that joy unfolds whenever we're able to enter and consent to the practice of opening to possibility. This morning, we light the fourth candle of our Advent wreath in the name of love, as an invitation for the Holy to dwell within us, deepening our capacity to love and to be watchful of love's presence among us. May we open to the love that awaits us in the weeks to come. As we prepare to bring new possibilities to life, may love guide us and be a creating force in our lives. Please join us now in the first verse of O Come, O Come, Emmanuel.
With your captive children dwell, give comfort to all exiles here, and to the aching heart be cheer. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come within as love.
Flame into life.
Rise up, O flame, by thy light glowing, show to us beauty, vision, and joy.
Thank you.
was going to tell you it would be okay to applaud, but I don't think I needed to do that. What a delightful thing. I've always wanted to have some dancing in our Sunday worship, and I'm so grateful to Annie Jocelyn and Tunda and Ezra for that beautiful, beautiful display of. And next year I'm going to make it to the Nutcracker, and thank you so much for that. So I, yeah. Talk about a high wire act. I mean, that was just incredible. Two young people grown up in our congregation. So glad to see you. You guys did great. We're going to learn a new song, Deck Us All. When I was a college freshman, Professor Amundson gave us extra credit if we would memorize this song, Deck Us All. You're familiar with the word. You're familiar with the tune, but maybe it's some new words. So we're gonna try to get through this. And if you can't get through it, don't worry. Anyway, and then we'll have our love arch afterwards. But I thought we should sing this song this year just for fun. Maybe it'll be an annual tradition. So are we ready? Go.
Deck us all with Boston Charlie, Walla Walla Wash and Kalamazoo. Norris freezing on the trolley, swallow dollar cauliflower alligaroo. Don't we know archaic barrel, lullaby lullaboy Louisville-loo. Trolley molly no don't love Harold, hula hula pants a cooler hullabaloo. More. Dunk us all in bowls of barley, hinky dinky dink and polly voo. Chili Philly's name is Charlie, Collie Philly's jolly chili view halloo. Bark us all, bow wows of folly, double bubble toil and trot, trouble, trouble, dotto.
About doing that in church, but you guys came through, and I think it's a good annual tradition. Let's start it this year. Let's form our love arch so the young. Oh, first of all, can all the young folks come up this way and just gather in the front of the sanctuary? We didn't have a story today. We had a dance story, and that was our time for all ages. So you guys come on up so that we can just recognize you, and we can say how grateful we are that young people are in our congregation. We love seeing you, and we're going to send you off through the love arch. So if you all would just get prepared for that, we can just do it right away. Just take a deep breath. It's such a hectic time of year. People rushing around, trying to buy their last minute gifts. So we just pause here for a moment and take a deep breath and collect ourselves and center ourselves so that we might bring our best selves forward to the world. At this time of year, when families are gathering, I think of all those who are separated from loved ones. I think of the immigrant parents whose children are in native lands while they have to work here to provide money for their young ones living at home. How hard it must be, how hard it must be to have to work so hard. I think of the men in the container ships floating around the world, away from their families. I think of those serving in the military, far away, not able to be with their loved ones. I think of all those who have no one to hug them, to hold their hand, to tell them that they're special. Let us always be mindful in our world to look around and to notice those who are being left out, that they might know our compassionate embrace. For compassion is our way. And gratitude. Think of all the people in this big world of ours toiling right now in the meatpacking plants, in the clothing factories, in the fields, how hard some people have to work so we can have what we have. I'm reminded of that hymn, the verse, "Take not for granted a privileged place." God's love embraces the whole human race. Let us be grateful for the efforts of those who put food on our table and clothes on our backs. Let us be aware of how hard they work for us. May we help to make their lives easier as a show of gratitude. Gratitude and compassion, this is the path we walk. Amen.
Of course, I flipped my hearing aid out, but good morning. I'm George Pitter. I'm the Lifeline's lay representative this morning. I don't have any personal joys and concerns to share. Excuse me.
They're not able to hear you right now. We're going to have to get the sound worked out.
Oh, okay. I'm your Lifeline's lay representative this morning. I don't have any personal joys and concerns to share with you, but I would like to light one candle for all the joys and concerns that haven't been spoken this morning. And we're here to help. And if you need help, we can be contacted at Lifelines Lay Ministry at uusalem.org. Thank you.
For our pastoral hymn, let us sing number 18 in the gray book, What Wondrous Love. Please remain seated. Wondrous love is this, O my soul, what wondrous love is this, O my soul, what wondrous love is this that brings my heart such bliss and takes away the pain of my soul, of my soul. Takes away the pain of my soul. When I was sinking down,
friends to me gathered round. Oh, my soul, oh, my soul, friends to me gathered round. Oh, my soul, to love and to all friends I will sing, I will sing. To love and to all friends I will sing. To
question underlies our experience. Whether we think about it consciously or not, what is the purpose of life? I believe that the purpose of life is to be happy. From the moment of birth, every human being wants happiness and does not want suffering. From the very core of our being, we simply desire contentment. I don't know whether the universe, with its countless galaxies and stars and planets, has a deeper meaning or not. But at the very least, it is clear that we humans who live here on this earth face the task of making a happy life for ourselves. From my own limited experience, I have found that the greatest degree of inner tranquility comes from the development of love and compassion. The more we care for the happiness of others, the greater our own sense of well-being becomes. Cultivating a close, warm-hearted feeling for others automatically puts the mind at ease. It's the ultimate source of success in life. Because we all share an identical need for love, it's possible to feel that anybody we meet, in whatever circumstances, is a brother or a sister. No matter how new the face or how different the dress and behavior, there's no significant difference between us and other people. It's foolish to dwell on external differences because our basic natures are the same. Even when we engage in ordinary conversation in everyday life, if someone speaks with human feeling, we enjoy listening and respond accordingly. The whole conversation becomes interesting. However unimportant the topic may be, let me emphasize that it is within your power, given patience and time, to develop this kind of compassion. We do not need to become religious, nor do we need to believe in an ideology. All that is necessary is for each of us to develop our good human qualities. I try to treat whomever I meet as an old friend. This gives me a genuine feeling of happiness. It is the practice of compassion.
Thank you, Janet, and thank you too, Kit. Some years ago, my family and we went down to Sequoia National Park down in California, and a forest ranger was guiding us on a short hike. And when we came to this scenic vista of mountain ranges, she invited us to turn our backs to this glorious scene and follow, bend over at the waist. It sounds like we're mooning the scene, but that's not what we were doing. Bend over at the waist and look out through our legs to get a truer perspective, because we would be looking at the world upside down. Why would that be a truer perspective? Well, the forest ranger noted how our brains have evolved to visually exaggerate the variation of the landscape. And this helped our ancestors find their way in the trackless wilderness. You can see how that would work. It's just a little bit of change in the gradation of the land. If it's exaggerated, helps you navigate yourself. And so she said that when you look at the world upside down, it appears to be flatter, and actually it is. It gives you a more accurate visual perspective. It seems to me that our minds play a similar trick by exaggerating the topography of human society. A conventional gaze at our society reveals a vast range of differences. You have multi-billionaires. I'm just waiting until we get our first trillionaire, you know. We have multi-billionaires and their towering skyscrapers, while far below are souls who are laid low by circumstances, sleeping on the sidewalks. From this view, we see quite a range. Those who have come out on top, those far down below on the bottom, and the rest of us in between somewhere. We see those who have status and those who don't. Those who fit in and the so-called misfits who don't fit in. There's a lot of extreme up and downs to be seen here. And we do see it. We refer to this topography, this uneven topography, as we navigate our lives amongst each other from day to day. It's an extremely uneven topography, and unnaturally exalts some people and casts others into lonely canyons of despair. It's amazing how much difference there is. And anyway, you just wonder, do we have to live in a world like this? It seems dehumanizing. It breaks my heart to see people out there in tents and tarps and everything, and then other people driving by in late model cars, and everything's cool for them but not for the other people. The way we look at everybody, the way we look at one another. There's no law that says you must personally embrace this uneven topographical perspective. In fact, every major religious tradition invites you not to reject these crass, dehumanizing views that equate people's worth, true worth, with their net worth. The wisdom traditions invite you to look at the world upside down so we can recognize our true spiritual equality. And thus the ancient Hebrew prophet Isaiah envisioned a world where every valley shall be exalted and every mountain and hill brought low. The crooked places shall be made straight and the rough places smooth. It's a vision of a world in which there are not great disparities. Simply put, the wisdom traditions invite you to walk the path of humility. Humility, where you can see the world from a truer upside down perspective. And if you're looking for guidance of how to walk on the path of humility, you can turn to Taoist or Confucian or Christian, Buddhist, Jewish, Islamic, Stoic sources. All these traditions point out humility is a good way to go in life. I like the way the Taoist sage Lao Tzu put it when he noted that those who follow the way are like water, which benefits all things and does not compete with them. It stays in lowly places that others reject. And this is why it is so similar to the way. I always like that imagery of water that flows and just serves. I like that. And humility is like that. It flows to benefit all. So it's good. It's important to read and reflect on the virtues, but the virtues are better learned and understood through actual practice and experimentation. And so I decided to humbly follow in the footsteps of Mohandas Gandhi, who titled his biography, My Experiments with Truth. Kind of like a scientist, My Experiments with Truth, which means that you experiment. You experiment with living in accordance with your understanding of the truth and see how it works out. And it's good to start with small steps to see where they will lead. So I set out to experiment with the practices of humility as best I could in the coffee shops, where I often work on my laptop, just to see how it would play out. I've worked on my laptop. I'm really glad that you, I have three offices, my home office, that one there, and the coffee shops. Laptops are great. You can take them and do some of the lighter work of ministry. And over the years, I've observed the flow of life there, and I realized that the best way for me to hone the virtue of humility in this setting is to strive to be the best customer I can be for the benefit of everyone. And to help me realize this, I have created a customer letter of agreement, which I present to the staff. It's here somewhere. We'll find it. A customer letter of agreement, which I present to the staff, the wonderful baristas upon entry. And this confounds them because, you know, what's this guy handing me? But once they read it, they take it back, they share it, they've passed it around, they put it up on the wall in the coffee shops. They are reassured after they read my customer letter of agreement. This is my way of letting them know that I'm somebody who strives to play by a different set of rules, spiritually grounded rules, not the ones devised by savvy merchants who invite us to treat their employees like servants instead of human beings. I was reading about this. There's a history behind the way we think of ourselves as customers. Back in the early 19th century, they realized that if you make people feel like they're rich and powerful, even for just a minute, they're going to really like it. The customer is always right. You know, create this system where the customer is up there all the time. And it feels good in some ways, but it doesn't seem healthy to me oftentimes when I see people shouting or yelling at salespeople. And so the subversive spirit of humility invited me to turn this whole structure upside down. And so I wrote this agreement, which I do observe, in which I do hand to the baristas.
Customer letter of agreement.
Notice she's wearing a barista apron, by the way.
Thank you for accepting me as a customer. I will do my best to be a good one in service to you and my fellow customers. Please know that I am always seeking to improve, so I welcome your feedback on how I can be a better customer in the future. In pursuit of my good customership, I will treat you with decency and respect, and if I should ever fail to do so, I will apologize. I know you are someone's precious child and deserve to be treated with kindness. Tip generously, because I know that times are hard, and extra money will help you in some way. In fact, let's not call it a tip at all. It's just a gift I have the opportunity to give. It's only fitting for me to be generous, since I have so often benefited from the generosity of others. I will be mindful of taking up too much of your time with conversation when you have other customers to serve. And I'm also glad to chat with you. It is unlikely that there should be a mistake with my order. I will be patient and understanding. After all, who doesn't make mistakes? Besides which, mistakes are often the fault of the other customers who take the wrong drink, even though you have to take the heat for it. I will take every opportunity to express my gratitude for the service, food, and drink. I will leave the premises seating area bathrooms, napkin counter, at least as clean as I find them, if not more so. I will pay attention for opportunities to be of service to my fellow customers. If other customers and I arrive simultaneously, I will offer to let them go ahead of me. If by moving to another seat I can create more seating for other customers, I will instantly move and make sure that the other customer knows there is seating available. If I see someone sitting nearby for a period of time who appears to be in distress and unable to purchase drink or food, I will discreetly ask if they will be my guest so that they might be able to sit and rest for a spell. And you won't be obliged by the necessary rules of the establishment to ask them to leave. If I see someone who has mobility challenges, I will do all the things I can do to help them enter, find a space to sit, or for their wheelchair to be. If I see another customer doesn't know the bathroom code and you're busy, I'll let them know because they really need to go. In general, I will strive to be friendly and kind with all my fellow customers, one and all. Once again, thank you for accepting me as a customer, and do let me know if I can improve. Humbly yours, Rick.
They don't expect that letter, and they're not sure what to make of it at first. But then they read it, and then they realize I'm pretty serious. And it sounds like a lot of work in the coffee shops. It's not. It's very simple to just pay attention and kind of help life feel that way. It feels like you're being helpful to other people, and I like that. And I like that the baristas like it, and they know who I am when I come in. They know I'm somebody who they can trust. I'm not going to give them a hard time. I'm going to treat them well. And it builds community, I've discovered, if you introduce yourself that way. I hadn't thought of it that way. And it had struck me that the spirit of Mahatma Gandhi was guiding me in the coffee shop. But I just, have any of you got DNA testing done? DNA, yeah, a few of us got the DNA testing. I got the results. I was really surprised to discover that I have border collie ancestors. We really like to help. We're just looking around for an opportunity to be of service. I'm kind of like a border collie guy, and I like helping other people. Maybe that's why I'm a minister. Anyway, I was really surprised by that. Anyway, back to Gandhi. Gandhi found his own spiritual grounding. He was mostly grounded in Hinduism's Bhagavad Gita. That was really his Bible. But Gandhi really got a lot out of the Christian scripture when he discovered Jesus of Nazareth, and he found this ancient Jewish prophet to be a very good model for the practice of humility. And I look to Gandhi as a great example of what humility looks like in our world. I don't think there's anybody in recent memory, historical memory, who provides, Mother Teresa maybe, provides a clear example of what true humility looks like. And I love the way that Gandhi, in order to level the playing field, he looked to the most despised, neglected people in his society, the untouchables, the Dalit people, and he called them Harijan, children of God. He called them that to say, you are to be lifted up. You whom the rest of society despises, I call you children of God, Harijan. Unfortunately, that term has been abused such that now it's not even considered a good thing to say, and it's actually against the law in India to call Dalit people Harijan, children of God. But the original impulse of Gandhi in doing this was to esteem them. It was to show his own humility in reference to other people. Now, in regards to my drawing attention to my humble behavior in the coffee shop, how does that jive with Jesus' advice? He said, warning not to draw attention to your good behavior. You know, that's what the Pharisees and the Sadducees do. But don't draw so much attention when you're being virtuous. Isn't this just a kind of like virtue signaling moral exhibitionism on my part? No, it's virtue pride. Virtue pride, since virtue signaling is all talk and no action, but virtue pride is something you do, and you're proud of it. In fact, let's turn this into a competition, a virtue competition, a humility competition. Wouldn't that be something? Who can you be humbler than me? Can you be better at being humble? We'll start today. I'm going to pass out some cards during the fellowship hour, and it'll say, thank you for accepting me as a customer, and it says the little thing. And if you want to use it, you can go out and try to one-up me in the area of humility. And if so, come back next week and tell me how you've done better, and I will humbly acknowledge that you're humbler than me, that you're better at humility than I am. But we'll hand out the cards during the fellowship hour if you want to get out there and play. What a crazy idea comes from this pulpit sometime. A virtue competition, my goodness. Well, you know, in the Zen Buddhist, Tibetan Buddhist traditions, the monks, they engage in something they call Dharma combat. Dharma combat. It's where they match their understanding of the Dharma. It's a back and forth dialogue. It's not an ego battle, but it's to see how they can sharpen their understanding of the truth by having this dialogue going back like that. It's not for your personal victory. It's for the victory of higher truth. That's why you have Dharma combat. So I guess I'm suggesting we engage in virtue combat. What an interesting thought. Virtue combat. I have a feeling it's not going to catch on. But I think the idea has some merit as long as practitioners stay tethered to reality, keep the ego out of it. Imagine if congregations and a community engaged in virtue combat. Wouldn't that be fun, huh? Who can be the most virtuous in the community? Who can do the most good for the most people in our community? I think our congregation would come out looking pretty good for the most part. A virtue competition. Maybe that's not a good idea. Kind of silly. But it's not as silly as our common misunderstandings about the nature of humility and pride, true humility and true pride. If you misunderstand what those are about, you can look really silly if you fall prey to misunderstanding those two virtues. Too often, folks mistake their counterfeit versions for the real thing, false humility and false pride. And that's supposed to be the real thing. It's not. It's not. False humility involves self-abasement. It's like you're worth nothing. You're just nobody. That's false humility. True humility is grounded in healthy self-love. And it means that you want to lift everyone out of the basement. Society's dungeons of despair and neglect. Humility doesn't mean that you think so little of yourself. It's just that you think so much of everyone else and esteem other people. False pride leads you to believe you're different. You're kind of a cut above the rest of humankind. That's false pride. I'm different. I'm better. I'm somehow. True pride leads you to aspire to embody the best of humankind, to do your best, but to know that you're not better than the rest of us. Taking pride in a job well done is not a sin. You can be humble and proud at the same time. They don't cancel each other out. Sometimes I hear people joke, it's hard to be humble when you're great. To which I say, there's nothing greater than being truly humble, because then you realize that everyone is great. So I'm going to go forth and be humble, and the better I do, the prouder I'll be. Amen. Would you join me as I simply go deeper by going slower? going higher, by going slower, so that I can recognize the great spacious life, the dance floor of life, allows for many moves to be made. Seek to be graceful and humble and aware of the dancers around you. Help lift up those who have fallen. Help us move in a greater harmony and rhythm as we recognize the sacred worth in one another. Let us move together through this world, recognizing especially those who are despised and neglected, those who work so hard. Let us be aware of them. Let us be aware of our power to bring more love into this world. Let us flow like water to the lowly places and offer sustenance to those who need it. Let our compassion flow like water throughout our community. Amen and amen.
Friday next, we will gather here to celebrate the birth of Jesus of Nazareth. I don't know if he was a saint, a god, or simply a wise and humble man, but he left behind a message of kindness, love, and generosity. He spoke to his followers of the need to help and support all people, to think of the welfare of those less fortunate. In the spirit of the teachings of this great sage and the spirit of our own seventh principle, which tells us that we are part of an interconnected web of all existence, I ask you to show generosity in support of this congregation, its members, its ministries, and all our neighbors. This month, we are sharing our good fortune with IMIRJ, the Interfaith Movement for Immigrant Justice. They are an interfaith coalition called by faith and conscience to respond to the suffering of our immigrant brothers and sisters living here in the United States. We also support Marion Poke Food Share through food and monetary donations. Those present in the sanctuary today may leave their donations in the basket that is provided in the lobby. If you're joining us online, please go to uusalem.org to donate and follow the prompts. Your generosity really is appreciated, and your contributions are very gratefully received.
Thank you.
invite Reverend Rick to bring forward the and light the social justice lantern. It's a little tight up here today. Each week, we kindle this lantern from our community chalice, and this is to symbolize the spreading of our warmth and love of all the members of our congregation with the wider world. Jesus is quoted as saying, "You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others." As we extinguish our lamps, our chalices, I hope you take the light and warmth of our time together today. May each of us be a spark of light to feed fires of love and compassion that are so needed by so many this holiday season.
Will the children please come forward to receive an ornament? This is an annual tradition that stretches back earlier than my time here, and I've been here 29 years. Every year, the Women's Alliance, they make ornaments for the children to receive an ornament, a special ornament off the tree. So they're gonna do that, and keep your ornaments from year to year. You'll have a whole bunch of different ones. So let's get started.
She said that her children have ornaments that are at least 50 years old, which I can't believe she has children that are that old, so we'll just go there.
Let's let Kit play some music while we do this. Sorry. So where are you going to be Christmas Eve? I hope you're going to be here. We'll have a candlelight walk at 6:30. It'll be we'll all be carrying candles, walking around the facility, just to sort of create a sense of the fact that we're all together on a light-filled pilgrimage together. And then our Christmas Eve service will be at 7 o'clock. And it's going to be great. We have other things I'd like to draw your attention to. In preparation for the service, if you would write your prayer and send to Sarah Pickett at Sarah at UU Salem by December the 22nd. It's one of the rituals we have in our service to read prayers for the world. So next Sunday, Sarah Pickett, Bob Muir, and Barbara Stebbins Bowes are going to be blessing us with their a service the day after Christmas. Thank you guys for doing that. And we have a lot of stuff going on for our fundraising around here. It's January the 16th through the 23rd are donations for the auction. And we're still looking for Rembrandts and Van Goghs to add to that, or a baby grand piano would be all right too. We actually did have a piano contributed once, and it helped a lot. So if you are looking to get rid of something that's valuable, tax deductible. So thanks for all who organized that. We have other things going on, and the thank you all for getting a gift for the tree. We have a gift tree that we've participated in for people in our community who are disconnected, and they put a a request for a gift and we provide it, and it's a wonderful thing. And I think that that's pretty much filled up right now, so we don't have any more of those to do. RE, Religious Education Team, meets weekly if you'd like to join them. You can also pay attention to our website and our newsletter columns for all sorts of information about various activities going on in our life of our religious community. And is that it? Are there any other announcements? I think we've got them all. Good. Thank you.
Except I have one. So some of you may know and some of you may not that there's going to be quite a shakeup in our music program here. Dr. Kidd here is leaving us. He will be with us on Christmas Eve, and then he will take a full-time job. I don't know why he'd leave here, just to get a full-time job, but, you know, everybody has their own priorities. And Laura, who couldn't be with us today, is also leaving us. She will be leaving at the end of the year, but she will be also participating in Christmas Eve. We have a new music director. His name is Robert, and he will be starting, and I think you're going to really, really like him. But we are so sad to see Kit and Laura go, but we have gifts for them to say goodbye, and I wanted to present those in front of the whole congregation. I'm going to accept Laura's from her and run it over to her after service today, and I'm going to give Kit his. And we thank you so much.
Please stand if you're able and join me in our last hymn, Love Will Guide Us.
Love will guide us, peace has tried us, hope inside.
Hearts with everyone around you and all those who are part of our web of interconnectedness as we say our closing words. May faith in the spirit of life, hope for the community of earth, and love for the sacred in one another be ours now and in all the days to come.